This video series is to accompany the Cisco Netacad IT Essentials 7.0 course. This video is Chapter 14, The IT Professional. In Chapter 14, we're going to look at communication skills in the IT professional, operational procedures, ethical and legal issues in the IT industry, and call center technicians. Communication skills in the IT professional. The relationship between the communication skills and troubleshooting skills for an IT technician, you will need to troubleshoot a computer, but you also need to learn the details of the problem from the customer. And most people who need a computer problem fixed are probably feeling a little bit stressed out because their computer is down. And so you need to establish a good rapport with the customer, make them feel relaxed, and try to get the information out of them to be able to repair the computer quickly. If you're talking with the customer in person, that customer can see your body language, so make sure that you're professional. And when you're talking to a customer on the phone, make sure that you're smiling and that you're communicating and not being condescending, and that because they can sense your attitude through the phone. You should know, call your customer by his or her name, ask if there's any particular name that they want to be referred to. You can relate, create a one-on-one connection between you and your customer, and then understand their problem. For example, a customer who is new to computers will likely not know all the computer jargon, so make sure that you're not using special acronyms and things like that. Make sure that you're explaining things out fully. But if you're working with a customer that's more experienced, you should be able to use what we call jargon or acronyms, things like that. You should use active listening. That allows the customer to tell the whole story. So during the time that the customer is explaining the problem, you could interject some small word or phrase such as "I understand" or "yes," but you do not want to interrupt the customer to ask questions or make statements. Just listen carefully when the customer is speaking and let them finish their thoughts. Then ask open-ended questions, usually involving information about what the customer was doing, what they were trying to do, and why they're frustrated. And then after listening to the customer explain the whole problem, summarize, and then follow up with closed-ended questions, such as that can be answered with a yes or a no. You want to use professional behavior with customers. When dealing with customers, it's sometimes easier to explain what you should not do. So the following list describes things you should not do when talking with a customer. Do not minimize a customer's problems. Don't use jargon or acronyms, abbreviations, and slang. Don't be negative or have a negative attitude in your tone of voice. Don't argue with the customer or become defensive. Don't say culturally insensitive remarks. Don't disclose any experiences with customers on social media. Don't be judgmental or insulting. Avoid distractions and do not interrupt when talking with customers. Don't take personal calls when talking with the customer or texting. Don't talk to coworkers about the unrelated subjects when talking with the customer. Avoid unnecessary holds and abrupt holds with the customer. Make sure that you ask for their permission to be put on hold before you put them on hold, and make sure that it's not for too long. Do not transfer a call without explaining the purpose of the transfer and then getting the customer's consent to be transferred. And do not use negative remarks about other technicians to the customer. Some tips for putting customers on hold and transferring is let the customer finish explaining the problem. Say that you must put the customer on hold, ask for their permission, and then when the customer agrees, thank the customer and explain that you expect to be back in a few minutes, or let them know a reasonable expectation of time. Explain what you'll be doing during that time. And if after the placing the call on hold, it takes longer than you expected or the customer, make sure that you pick back up and tell them that you're still working on the issue. And you do not want to interrupt the customer, put a customer on hold without an explanation, put a customer on hold without the customer's consent, or assume that your time is more valuable than the customer's time. And then when you're transferring a call, let the customer finish explaining the problem, you know, say why you must transfer, and then tell the new technician who will be receiving the call the name, the ticket number, and the customer's name. Make sure you keep the customer call focused. Use proper language. Listen and question with open-ended and closed-ended questions. And then give feedback to the customer. Let the customer know that you understand the problem, and you should develop a friendly and positive conversational manner. Operational procedures. For documentation overview, you want to provide documents provide descriptions for how products, software, and hardware function through the use of diagrams, descriptions, and manual pages. Standardized procedures and practices are also set so that they can be repeated accurately in the future. You also establish rules and restrictions on the use of the organization's assets, including acceptable use policies for internet, network, and computer usage. Documentation also reduces confusion and mistakes, saving time and resources. It also helps with complying with governmental or industry regulations, and it also helps with training new employees or customers. The IT department documentation, you can have policy documents, which outline policy, security policies, regulatory compliance policies. You can also have operation and planning documents, such as the IT strategy and planning documents, proposals for future projects, budgets and purchasing records. You can also have project documents for user requests and changes, software designs, logical and physical network topologies, and then user documentation, such as end user manuals, help desk tickets database software, and searchable knowledge base articles and FAQs. Many IT, or there's a lot of areas in IT that are regulated by either federal, state, or local, and even industry regulations, and they can have documentation requirements over and above what is normally documented. So regulatory and compliance policies often specify what data must be collected, how long it must be retained, and a few of the regulations may have implications on the internal company processes, and some regulations require keeping extensive records regarding how the data is accessed and used. And failure to comply with laws and regulations can have severe consequences, including fines, termination of employment, or even incarceration of offenders. Now, the change control process, this is an example of a change control worksheet. You would have the proposed change, the scope of the change, the intended outcome, and then the implementation plan. A disaster recovery overview. A disaster recovery plan is a comprehensive document that describes how to restore operations quickly and keep critical IT functions running during or after a disaster. The disaster recovery plan can include information such as offsite locations, where services can be moved, information on replacing network devices. It can also show talk about services that may need to be available during the disaster, web services and internet connectivity, data stores, database and application servers, telephone and email, and other communication services. So preventing downtime and data loss, you can use cloud backups. The advantages are they're reliable and scalable. The disadvantage is that it takes time to transfer it across the network, and also discontinuation of services or increases in prices. And local backups, the advantages are you have local control, accessibility, and speed, but the disadvantage is the scalability and offsite storage requirements. There's five phases to a disaster recovery plan. You have phase one, the network design and recovery strategy. Two, inventory and documentation, verification, approval and implementation, and then the review. Ethical and legal considerations. You should respect your customers as well as their property. Computers and monitors are property, but property also includes any information or data that might be accessible. For example, emails, phone lists, records and data, hard copies of file information or data left on the disk, so they should all be treated as property of the customer. Examples of personal identifiable information, or PII, could be names, maiden name, mother's name, personal identification numbers such as social security numbers, passports, driver's license, personal characteristics including photographic images, especially facial recognition, fingerprints, handwriting, biometric data. That should all be considered personal identifiable information and considered to be kept strict as far as it belongs to the customer. The payment card industry, or PCI, that information is considered personal information as well, and that needs to be protected. The PCI Security Standards Council was formed in 2005. And if you want to learn more about that, that's the link right there. Protected health information, or PHI, is another form of PII that needs to be secured and protected. It includes patients' names, addresses, dates of visits, telephone and fax numbers, email addresses. And with the move from paper copies to record and electronic copies, electronic protected health information, or EPHI, is also regulated. And penalties for breaches of PHI and EPHI are severe, and they're regulated by the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, or HIPAA. Now, there are legal considerations in IT. There's laws in different countries and legal jurisdictions, so it is not permissible to make any changes to system software or hardware configurations without customers' permissions. It's not permissible to access a customer's or coworker's accounts without permission. It's also not permissible to install, copy, or share digital content without the permission of the customer, or making sure that copyright and trademark laws, they do vary between states and countries, so those need to be adhered to as well. You should not be using a customer's company IT resources for commercial purposes, and it's not permissible to make customers' IT resources available to unauthorized users. And also, you should not knowingly use a customer's company resources for illegal activities. And it's not permissible to share sensitive customer information. You're required to maintain the confidentiality of that data. Now, when it comes to licensing, it is illegal to use licensed software without the appropriate license. An example of a personal software license is an end-user license agreement. An enterprise license is software license and it's held by a company for its employees. Open source licensing is a copyright license for software that allows developers to modify and share the source code that runs on that software. And if you use software to make money, you must pay for a commercial license. And digital rights management, or DRM, is software that's designed to prevent illegal access to digital content and devices. Computer forensics, when data from computer systems, networks, wireless communications may need to be collected and analyzed in the course of a criminal investigation, the collection and analysis of the data for that purpose is called computer forensics. And the process of computer forensics encompasses both IT and specific laws to ensure that any data collected is admissible as evidence in court. Data that's collected in computer forensics can either be persistent data, that's data that's stored on a local drive, such as an internal or external hard drive, or an optical drive, or volatile data, such as information that's in the RAM, cache, or registries, and or data in transit between a storage medium and a CPU. If you're reporting illegal activity and are part of an incident response team, it's important to know how to capture that data because it disappears as soon as the computer's turned off. Cyber law is a term used to describe international, regional, country, and state laws that affect computer security professionals. IT professionals must be aware of cyber law so that they understand their responsibility and their liability as it relates to cyber crimes. And cyber laws explain the circumstances under which data can be collected from computers, data storage devices, networks, and wireless communications. They can also specify the manner in which this data can be collected. First response is the term used to describe official procedures employed by those people who are qualified to collect evidence. Routine administrative tasks can affect the forensics process. And you may be the person who discovers illegal computer or network activity. Do not turn off the computer. Volatile data about the current state of the computer can include programs that are running. So that data helps to determine a logical timeline of the security incident. It may also help to identify those responsible for the illegal activity. So you want to be familiar with your company's policy regarding cybercrimes, know who to call, what to do, and just as important, know what to not to do and how to document. And on documentation, if you discover illegal activity on a computer, you want to make sure that you document the initial reason for accessing the computer, the time and date, any peripherals that are connected to the computer, network connections, the physical area where the computer is located, any illegal material that you have found, illegal activity that you've witnessed or suspect that has occurred, which procedures that you've executed on the computer and network as well. You also want to keep a chain of custody. Chain of custody references to prove chain of custody. First responders have documentation procedures in place that track the collective evidence. If evidence is going to be going to court or used in a court of law, you need to be able to say from point A to point B what happened to the evidence. So incorporate customer forensics procedures into your approach to computer network security to ensure that these procedures help you capture necessary data. You want to ensure that the viability of the integrity of the captured data helps you prosecute the intruder. Call center technicians. A call center environment is organized and professional. Customers call in to receive computer-related help. And the workflow of a call center starts with calls from the customers displayed on a call board. Level one technicians answer those calls, and if they cannot solve the problem, it's escalated to a level two. And the technician must supply the level of support that is outlined in the customer service level agreement or an SLA. Computers and call centers have support software that technicians use to manage many of their job functions. They log and track incidents, they run diagnostic utilities, they research a knowledge base, or they collect customer feedback. Level one technician responsibilities include contact information, what is the manufacturer model of the computer, what operating system, is the computer plugged into the wall or is it running on battery, have any new drivers or updates been installed, description of the problem, and priority of the problem. A level two technician would escalate that issue, and they might ask questions such as user complains that the laptop won't boot, software was added, and the level one technician cannot answer these, cannot solve these issues, so they escalate it to this level, and the level two technician will have a higher level of skill or access to information to be able to solve these problems that it could not be fixed at the level one. Now, customer service technicians will have scripts. A script file is a simple text file written in scripting languages to automate processes and tasks. A script file might be used to automate the process of performing a backup. The script file can save the technician a lot of time, especially when the same tasks need to be performed on many different computers. And you should be able to identify the many different types of script files because a script file may be causing a problem at startup or during a specific event. And these are some examples of scripts that you can run. Now, some different scripting languages that you might use is a Windows batch file, using the PowerShell, Linux shell, Java, or Python. You might have some basic script commands in Windows, such as doing a directory command, clear the screen, display the date, copy files. You can also set variables. You can set environmental variables, and then the different variable types are listed down here. You can also write conditional statements. Those are needed for the scripts to make decisions. Those statements usually come in from some form of if-else or case statement. You can have loops, while loops, for loops, and do-while loops.